Hello, everyone. Good evening, and welcome to the Penn Literature Awards for 2010. This has been a very exciting year for Penn, with many, many new developments. Among them, you'll notice that tonight, out of the 14 awards that will be given, two of them are brand new. The first, an exciting collaboration with ESPN for literary sports writing, and the second, the first Penn W.G. Sebald Award for fiction writer in mid-career. Additionally, tonight we'll celebrate the third conferral of the Penn Saul Bellow Award for Literary Achievement in American Fiction, and we will also see the continuation of our several Hallmark Translation Awards. One project especially close to my heart is a new collaboration with WNYC's Green Space. It's a global piano and literary salon that I will be hosting, and it will be a live event. The first one will be October 21st, featuring literature and piano of Cuba, and Oscar Huelos and Chuchito Valdez will be our first guests. But tonight we're here first and foremost to celebrate the extraordinary generosity of the funders and supporters of Penn, and the extraordinary achievements in literature that have happened over the last year. Please note that citations for each of tonight's winners and each of tonight's nominees are in your programs if you need to follow along. And with no further ado, I'd like to introduce Matthew Goldstein, the Chancellor of the City University of New York, who has generously allowed us to use this space this evening.
I am using an iPad for the first time, so if there is a mechanical problem, I'll have to deal with it. So let me see if I can work this. And I know we have an expert here that could be very helpful. Let's see if this works. And it does. So good evening. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to the Prashansky Auditorium of the City University of New York's Graduate School and University Center, and to be the host for this year's 210 Penn Literary Awards. All of us at CUNY are delighted to be the site for this premier literary event, and I am particularly honored to be in the company of my dear friend Steve Eisenberg, who over a lunch several weeks ago said, "Do you mind coming and giving readings?" So Steve, it's always my pleasure to be with you and to support this, this terrific event. It's also an honor for me to be in the presence of your board and all of Penn's distinguished members. I thank you all for your many contributions to broadening our understanding of the world, our imaginations, and our collective humanity. And I thank the Penn American Center for continuing to be a voice for free expression. CUNY is proud to be a partner with all of you. At this institution, we also take particular pride in our own award-winning faculty writers, including our Penn winner for poetry, Kimiko Han. Our faculty are active in our outstanding creative writing and journalism programs, including undergraduate degrees, master's degrees in creative writing, literary criticism, literary translation, and journalism, centers and institutes, and specialized programs across all of our campuses. Here at the Graduate Center, the Writers Institute enables writers to hone their craft with highly accomplished editors. And the Leon Levy Center for Biography is a hub for discussion about the art and craft of biographical narratives. So on behalf of all of us at this university, I welcome you to our Graduate School and University Center and offer my warmest congratulations to tonight's award winners and to all of you who instruct, entertain, surprise, engage, and even mystify us with your writing. So with no further ado, it is my honor now to turn the podium over to the president of the Penn Board of Trustees, Anthony Appiah. Thank you.
That We're extremely grateful to the Graduate Center for hosting us on this important event in the life of the Pan American Center. I just wanted to say a word about the connection between the two main things that we do at the Pan American Center. As the Chancellor mentioned, one of the main things we do is work for free expression. We're an organ of the American literary community organized in the service of free expression. That's one of the things we are. And some of you will know, I hope all of you by now know, that in the last week we've had a success, because over the last couple of years we've been working very hard on questions of free expression in China, and in the spring we nominated a Chinese writer, a former president of the Pan American Center, the independent Chinese Pan Center, Liu Xiaobo, for the Nobel Peace Prize, and last Friday the Nobel Peace Prize agreed with us that that was a good idea. And so, you'll have to go to our website to see the many, many things that we've done in connection with free expression in China in general and with Liu Xiaobo in particular. But it is a very exciting moment for us that we can feel that we have contributed to shaping the possibilities for free expression in China. Helping to contribute to that is very important to us. And it is important to us that Liu Xiaobo is not only an activist and an important voice for democracy in China, but he's also a poet. And that brings me to the other great thing that the Pan American Center and all the Pan Centers of the world represent, which is a concern for sustaining the literary cultures of their own societies and building connections between the literary cultures of each society and the literary cultures of the world, strengthening the understanding, appreciation of literature, helping writers to do this extraordinary thing without which, in my own view, without which much of almost everything else we do would be a good deal less worthwhile. And in the course of that project, in the course of sustaining literature in our country and its connections with literature abroad, well, this is one of the great days in the life of our organization, because on this day we celebrate some of our great writers and some of those who are contributing through the work of translation to connecting our literary community, our readers, with the writers of other nations. So it's, we have many of our members, of course, are here as writers who are going to receive awards. They're here as the writers who participated in helping to select the award winners, and they're here also to present, to speak about their fellow writers who have won. And I'm very grateful to all those in our organization who have worked so hard to make it possible for us to come here tonight and to celebrate this other great thing that we do along with our work for free expression, which is to build the community of literature, build the strength of literature in our country, and build its connections with the literatures of the human race. So onward and upward, I wish you all a very pleasant evening.
So many of those who will be presenting this evening are the judges, and we wanted to take a moment to thank the many, many women and men who've taken dozens of hours of their time to read, well, hundreds of hours of their time, most likely, to read dozens of books and to confer with their fellow judges. So if all of the judges in the room could possibly stand up for a moment, we'd like to just shower you with applause. Thank you. And with that, I'd like to present Richard Sieburth, invite him to the stage to present the Pen Award for Poetry and Translation. This is created through a bequest from Ray Dalvin and now sustained through a grant from the Kaplan Foundation.
Translated literature, as you know, represents, scandalously, only about 2% of the total publishing output of the United States. Within this, poetry translation represents something less than 0.5%. This year, there were 48 entries in the poetry translation categories, which I had a very enjoyable summer reading through. They were from publishers Microscopic, Small, Medium Size, as well as from university and commercial presses. Some 13 of these were from the Spanish, 5 from the French, 4 from the Chinese, 4 from the ancient Greek, 3 from the Italian, and the rest distributed across an impressive array of languages, including Nahuatl, Tibetan, Tamil, Romanian, Serbian, Hebrew, German, Portuguese, Latin, Polish, Bengali, and so on. Since you have my judges' citations in your program, I don't think there's really need to introduce our recipients in greater length. The two finalists, as you see in your program, were Seamus Heaney for his translation from the Scots of the Testament of Cressid and Seven Fables by Robert Henryson, and Rika Lesser for her translation from the Swedish of Mozart's Third Brain by Göran Sonnevi. Rika, I think, is in attendance. Could you please stand? Our winner in this category is Anne Carson for her translation from the Greek of an Oresteia. And Anne Carson, as my friends at New Directions have told me, is after the smashing success of her recent Knox, is currently engaged in yet another multimedia translation, or as we say in the trade, intersemiotic translation. This time, a comic book version of Antigone. Anne Carson, could you please come to the stage?
Thank you. I thought since I got a prize for translation that I would begin by giving you a little example of a translation to show you the rigor with which we work. This is a poem told to me by a dog, and it's in dog. I will render it in English for you non-dog speakers. Dog's poem. You gonna eat that? You gonna eat that? You gonna eat that? I'll eat that. Thank you.
Thank you. The Penn Translation Fund Awards, a hallmark of Penn's Literary Awards program, does something a little different than the last award, which is support the creation of new work. Michael Moore will now present the awards and provide some context. I'm sorry, and we will also call him up. The power of the written word is a bit of a conundrum right now. We're also going to call him up, if we could, with Marjolijn de Jager.
The Penn Translation Prize honors book-length translations from any language into English, published in the year 2009. It is Penn's oldest award, established in 1963. It was the first prize given by writers in the United States to recognize excellence in literary translation. For Alison Waters, Peter Constantine, and me, it was an amazing and often joyful experience to have read more than 100 books, so many of which were truly outstanding works, and this certainly speaks well for the art of translation. The two runners-up for the translation prize are Esther Allen and David Constantine. Esther Allen's excellent translation of José Manuel Prieto's novel Rex captured the many complex registers of his masterful prose. David Constantine, in his translation of the second part of Goethe's Faust, undertook one of the most difficult feats in translation and wonderfully recreated in English Goethe's masterpiece of poetry. Making a final choice led to several excellent discussions, and it is our great privilege to have selected Michael Henry Heim's superb rendering of the Flemish Hugo Claus's novel Wonder. Heim's translation has succeeded brilliantly in mirroring the many voices in this complex novel, as well as in maintaining Claus's deeply poetic language, attesting to the translator's intensely focused mind and finely tuned ear. And Michael Moore will accept for Michael Henry Heim.
I'm going to read this straight because Marjolijn said she's going to hit me with that thing if I didn't. Anyway, but I'm really happy that the award was given to Mike. He's a professor at UCLA, a great translator from 20 languages, the last anyone counted, and I think that he's just added Dutch to the list. An extraordinarily generous guy with fellow translators, with his students, which is why he couldn't be here tonight. There is nothing I would have liked more than to be with you this evening. But my day job is as a teacher at the far side of this country, and since that day job pays for my translation habit, in this country, full-time literary translator is still an oxymoron, my obligation is to remain here with my students. We have few or no full-time literary translators, but translation has been coming up in the world, even in our world, and the Translation Committee of the Pan American Center has played a major role in the consciousness-raising process here. I didn't tell him to write that. The annual translation prize is an integral part of that process, and like my fellow translators, I am grateful for the recognition it brings to our efforts, but even more to the works we bring into English. I am also grateful to Archipelago Books, whose unstoppable driving force, Jill Schulman, who is here, has and who really does deserve a round of applause for the work that she's done in translation. Has made a policy of publishing non-sell books and a practice of selling them. It was Jill who brought Wonder to my attention and saw the translation process through with good, old-fashioned hands-on editing. I'm grateful to the Flemish Literary Fund for subsidizing the translation fee and to the Flemish scholar. He wrote it out for me phonetically, so I'm sure of my pronunciation, Joris Doubtshaver. Not only for writing the book-length monograph on Wonder that gave me the courage to undertake the project, but also for graciously and elegantly answering my many queries about its language and cultural context. And speaking of courage, I am grateful to the Penn jury for recognizing that the passages where the narration appears to break down represent the author's intention rather than the translator's incompetence. I almost mispronounced that. I urge you to have a look at the excerpts of this extraordinary novel on the Pan American website and to acknowledge the right-headedness of Jill's Archipelago policy by moving on to the book itself. Thank you, Mike. Now I get to be me again. And in looking at the program, it's sort of hard to overlook the fact that on one end we have translation, and on the other hand we have drama. So it's sort of very tempting to mix the two. And with David Mamet in attendance, I sort of wanted to hone my prose to short, angry sentences. But it was a little tough to do. With the Translation Fund, we did insert some humor this year, happily, because we go through approximately, from 120 to 150 applications from all over the world every year, of books that haven't been published, and of books that are advocated by translators in a big way. The translators are the ones that received the award, which was created thanks to a single generous grant that Penn has shepherded very wisely, and that Esther Allen, through her vision, has sort of helped to bring it to the point where it is today. In the past 7 years, a whole variety of languages have been present, but if we just look at the most recent statistics, if I can find them, we've given grants of $2,000 to $3,000 to a total of 72 translations from 30 languages. In the first 5 years of operation, 76% of the grant winners have been published or are forthcoming from a publisher. Many of those books found their publishers as a result of being awarded a grant by the fund. And I would sort of also add that in the past 2 years, we've been aided by annual grants from Amazon, and we have partnered in an interesting way both with the New York State Council of the Arts, to which we nominate one of the applications that doesn't receive an award, and this year they did give an award to Myung-hee Ki for Steel and Fish Korean Stories, and we've partnered with the Robert Fagles Award, to whom we present our poetry submissions. And one of the submissions this year was just announced today, received the Fagles Prize for The Rest of the Voyage, a translation by Elena Rivera of the French poet Bernard Noël. This year, we are giving grants to 11 applicants from 10 languages in a variety of genres and over a broad swath of history: drama, poetry, short stories, novels, and flash fictions. One of my favorite quote in terms of trying to describe the difficulty in categorizing any of this is from Copenhaga by a Polish poet living in Copenhagen, which he says is far from Poland and far from Denmark. Not all of the winners are here today, but those who are, I have your names, and please stand up when I mention your name. The winners this year are Daniel Brunet for The Last Fire, a play by Dia Laura that examines the devastation wrought on a small community by the accidental death of a child. Alexander Daw for a collection of short stories by Ahmet Hamdi Tanpur, the most surprising writer of 20th century Turkish literature. Peter Golub and Ainsley Morse, who I believe are here. Thank you. For a collection of flash fiction by Lenore Gorelick, an underground Russian author. And I'd have to say that flash fiction was definitely the discovery of the pile this year. There were applicants from various countries in the world all practicing this short prose form. Peter Gwiazda for Copenhagen. Peter, are you here? Yes. For Copenhaga by Grigory Wroblewski, a Polish poet who has lived in Copenhagen since 1985. David Hull for Waverings, a novel by Mao Du from the Chinese. Akin Loy A. Oja for Afaimo and Other Poems, a poetry collection by Akin Wumi Isola, one of the foremost figures in Yoruba literature. Angela Rodel, who I believe is here, for Holy Light, stories by Georgi Tenyev. A Bulgarian playwright, novelist, film, TV screenwriter, and talk show host. Margot Rosen, you're here, yes, for Poetry and Untruth. A novel by Anatoly Naiman, juxtaposing the fates of four Russian poets of the early 20th century with those of the generation that came of age during Khrushchev's thaw. A part novel, part historical document. Chip Rossetti, working not from Italian, but from Arabic. For Animals in Our Days, short stories by Mohamed Makhzangi, an Egyptian psychiatrist, journalist, and fiction writer who was studying alternative medicine in Kiev during the Chernobyl nuclear accident. Bilal Tanwir for Love in Chikiwara and Other Such Adventures. A 1964 novel by Muhammad Khalid Akhtar that has long been considered a masterpiece of Urdu humor. I thought Chikiwara was in Pennsylvania, but I guess I'm wrong. And finally, Diane Thiel for The Great Green, a 1987 novel by Eugenia Fakinou, a hugely popular novel in Greece, where it is now in its 43rd reprint. Thank you very much, and congratulations.
So this next award also aims to support the translation of new work. This is the Penn Edward and Lily Tuck Award for Paraguayan Literature, founded by Penn member Lily Tuck, author of the National Book Award-winning novel The News from Paraguay, in memory of her husband Edward. The award will be given to translate a work of Paraguayan literature from Guarani or Spanish into English. Juror Tracy Lewis is here to present the award.
When Lily Tuck published her novel, The News from Paraguay, I think it caused a much greater stir in Paraguay than I'm sure she bargained for, both in a positive and a negative way, but it's a wonderful novel. And she was invited to Paraguay to see the country and to experience the life of the country, and was given such a royal welcome that in gratitude to Paraguay, she endowed this prize. I think our recipient, Esteban Bedoya, must hold the record for distance travel to be here, having come all the way from Australia, where he represents his country in the diplomatic corps. I too came a certain distance to be here, nowhere near as far as Esteban came, but I came from Syracuse in any case. Went to a certain amount of trouble to be here. I don't say this to blow my own horn, but to make the point that I feel a kind of obligation to Paraguay, to its culture, to its literature, not only for what those represent intrinsically, but because there is, I think, to the detriment of much that we experience in this world today, a kind of paradigm that seems to say that those of us who live in countries like the United States are the dispensers of everything that is good and worth knowing and worth experiencing. Of course, this operates on an unconscious level. Most people wouldn't actually say that. But I believe that the Pen Club stands foursquare against that unfortunate notion. Paraguay is a country which has much to teach all of us. And the work of the Pen Club and this prize in particular represent the notion of reciprocity in the learnings and the experiencings of human culture. Esteban wrote this wonderful book, El Apocalipsis Según Benedicto, and I am very happy to invite him up to the stage to receive his prize. And I give it not only on behalf of Lily Tuck and Edward Tuck and the Pen Club, but also with gratitude to my fellow jurors, Jennifer and Janina, who couldn't be here tonight. Esteban. As we say in Spanish, te felicitamos. As we say in Guarani, roguero joru. We congratulate you.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much. Just very few words in order to say thanks to Pan American Center and Lily Tax, because it's a big open door for the Paraguayan literature, and I'm very happy because I'm the winner. And the second step, very important, very important, is the translation, because as you know, if the translation is not good, the book is nothing. So I have a big hope in order that the translation will improve the original. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Like the previous two awards, the next prize, the Penn Phyllis Naylor Working Writer Fellowship, helps to bring a work of literature into the world, but in this case, it acts as a midwife to an outstanding work of children's literature that is still in progress. As Judge Dan Greenberg comes to the stage to present the Penn Phyllis Naylor Working Writer Fellowship, can Phyllis Reynolds Naylor, who I believe is here with us this evening, please stand?
Thank you. I've been told I have 120 seconds, so I'm going to do my best. When we first got the manuscripts in for the Phyllis Naylor Fellowship Award, we were overwhelmed. The entries were so good, they were so exciting, and I and my fellow judges, Suzanne Fisher-Staples and Elise Broach, wondered how to even attack this. And then Suzanne had a great idea. She said, why don't each of us just pick our top three and give each other our top three lists? And when we exchanged lists, we found that only one book had made it onto all three lists, and that was Bluefish by Pat Schmatz. And so that automatically and quickly became our winner. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about Bluefish. It's about two main characters, eighth graders, Travis, who secretly doesn't know how to read, and Velveeta, who is very smart and very witty and very outgoing as Travis is diffident. And Travis is the new boy at school. Anyway, they're really compelling characters, and it's a wonderful novel. I wanted to read you just four sentences that I circled that I particularly liked. One was, she looked directly into his eyes like she was reading whatever was written on the back wall of his brain. Another, cool fingers of breeze stretched through the half-open window and the birds hollered a racket outside. A third, the hot liquid inside Travis turned immediately to cold sludge. Fourth, he lit up so red you could find your way through a dark tunnel by the glow on his face. I thought those were really nice. Anyway, Pat Schmatz grew up in rural Wisconsin. She went to Michigan State University and the University of California at Berkeley. And to supplement her writing income, she's done things as diverse as work as a forklift operator, a janitor, a fitness consultant, a stable hand, a library assistant, a legal secretary, and a shipping clerk. And she currently lives in Wisconsin in the woods, in the woods of her childhood, in a high-performance, sustainable house that she herself helped to design and physically build. She's the author of three novels for teens, Mrs. Ostronsky and the UFO, Circle the Truth, and Mouse Traps. This award was developed with the extreme generosity of Phyllis Naylor to assist gifted writers of children's fiction. It helps make possible an extended period of time to complete book-length work in progress of a high caliber. And now I'd like to ask Pat Schmatz to come up and receive her award.
Thank you so much. I am so deeply grateful to Penn and to Ms. Naylor. This has an impact on me both personally and my career that I can't begin to describe. So thank you very much.
And now we'll move back away from prose, back to poetry again. And I'd like to invite your Marie Ponceau to please join us on the stage to present the Penn Voelcker Award for Poetry. We wanted to see you do the catwalk.
This is heaven to be talking about Marilyn, who is a truly splendid writer, to give her the Penn Voelcker Award for Poetry. established by a bequest from Hans Voelcker for an American poet whose distinguished and growing body of work represents a notable, accomplished presence in American literature. That's our girl, Marilyn. I've known her since she was 17, 58 years, 1958. And I have never seen her sent to jail for anything criminal yet. She's done no harm. She is in that realm of poetry in which we try very hard to do no harm. She's a wonderful translator. When I think of her work over all the poets who have brought her into our lives, it has really been one of the starring roles in our world of translated poems. Not only Francophile, the Francophone, as well as regular French people. And I want to remind you that we know how important that role is, since we are, if not Francophone, Anglophone. We all speak in that dialect. And it has been Marilyn Hacker's work to bring that work among us. Her poems and translations are expressions of social or political pity and outrage. It is the pity and outrage of an aroused, alive, strong-minded, fair-minded sensibility, not just a program of convictions. These poems and translations bring life to life, and the award will now be handed over to her, I think, for Suzanne Gardiner.
Good evening. I'm honored to be Marilyn's stand-in tonight. She's in Paris and sent these words to read to you. It seems appropriate to say a few words about Hans Voelcker, who for me is more than a name on a program, whose life and work exemplify the distances American poetry can travel. I knew Hans briefly in the mid-60s when he was one of a number of poets and painters, mostly gay, involved with the San Francisco Renaissance, the friends, lovers, acolytes, and informal students of Jack Spicer, to migrate to New York, a group that included the poet Lewis Ellingham, later co-author of the first Spicer biography, the Scottish poet Helen Adam, painters Russell Fitzgerald and Bill McNeil. Hans, the renegade son of a rural Pennsylvania family, had moved to San Francisco and become part of what contemporary literary history now calls the Spicer Circle. He was the dedicatee or interlocutor of several of Spicer's poems and the author himself of a book of lyrical criticism of the work of Hart Crane, and a novel that still reads as experimental, refiguring Rimbaud and Verlaine as mid-American high school boys. I have to check that out. He died at the age of 50 in 1990, a man who chose a life of literary marginality and the liberty that can accompany it. He forwarded the modest inheritance that had enabled him to travel and write in his youth to other poets. No questions asked about their literary appartenance via pen, whose dedication to the freedom of expression worldwide he shared. I can only enjoy the links of coincidence and, after all, a corresponding passion for poetry that allow me to accept an award given in Hans's name. Thank you.
And now, pardon me, Literary Award Chair Alice Quinn, the woman who helped organize this year's judges and who is essential to the entire awards program. Will please come to the stage to present the next two awards. The first is the Penn Jacqueline Bograd Weld Award for Biography, and the second is the Penn Open Book Awards. And as she does, will Jackie Weld and Rodman Drake, the generous sponsors behind the Penn Jacqueline Bograd Weld Award for Biography, please stand.
Good evening. The Penn Jacqueline Bograd Weld Award for Biography was established through the generosity of Jackie Weld and Rodman Drake. I don't know whether you're here. I can't see. You were going to stand. It recognizes outstanding biographies published in 2009. The runners-up are Soul of the Age, A Biography of the Mind of William Shakespeare by Jonathan Bate, and The Strangest Man, The Hidden Life of Paul Dirac, Mystic of the Atom by Graham Farmello. Farmello's editor, vice president and editorial director of Basic Books, Lara Heimert, is in attendance here on behalf of him, and we'd like you to stand. I might not be able to see you. The award goes to Kessler by Michael Scammell. I'm just going to read two sentences from the citation because the judges were so totally enthusiastic. Michael Scammell has written a brilliant and intellectually impressive biography that does full justice to the complex character of its polymath subject, a Renaissance man in his range of learning and overreaching ambition. He shows the importance of a fascinating personality and leading intellectual who is at the center of all the political movements of his time and, with Darkness at Noon, changed the West's idea of Russia. Please come up, Michael.
Well, it's particularly gratifying to be introduced by my old friend, Alice Quinn. And I'd like to begin by thanking now, did I get the names right?
Elizabeth
Frank. First of all, the award. I didn't write them down.
Jacqueline
Bograd and Robin Weld.
And Rodman
Drake. Thank you very much. I have a lot of thanks to say. I'd like to congratulate my fellow biographers, Jonathan Bate and Graham Farmelo, and say I'm pleased to be in such distinguished company. And yes, I'd like to thank American Penn, with which I've had a long association, particularly in the realm of freedom of expression, and also the judges who made this award possible. In my experience, the art of the biographer is often overshadowed by the fame, or sometimes infamy, of his subject. And this is especially the case when one has chosen a character like Arthur Kessler, whose contrary nature was notorious and whose faults were outsized. What I tried to do in this biography was not to minimize those faults, but to capture the full complexity of the man. I wanted to emphasize Kessler's virtues more than his vices, his blazing honesty, his intellectual courage, his yearning for justice, his willingness to swim against the tide, and I hope to direct readers back to his books, which are as well worth reading today as when they were written. I also approached Kessler's life and career as a prism through which to view the ideological and political conflicts of the 20th century, which are exercising more influence on our present travails than is generally realized. I cannot possibly thank enough the hundreds of people who helped me. I'd like to make mention of my editor at Random House, Will Murphy, and his team, my formidable but adorable agent, Amanda Urban, and above all, my best reader, my wife, Rosemary Nosif. Thank you.
And now for the first of this year's new awards, we will go to the Penn ESPN Award for Literary Sports Writing. It brings attention to an often overlooked genre. The Penn ESPN Award is the result of an exciting new collaboration with ESPN, and all of us at Penn would like to thank ESPN for its support. Now Robert Lipsight is here to announce the winner and the finalists.
Well, it took this amazing unholy alliance between two of the great worldwide empires, Penn and ESPN, to affirm that sports writing is writing. As a sports writer, I am grateful and delighted. As a judge, however, and I'm speaking for my colleagues Tim O'Brien and Susan Orlean, both happily traveling for books right now, the selection process was daunting, which was why we petitioned the worldwide empires to let us choose three runner-ups instead of two. We needed that final four. They were all of championship caliber, all fierce contenders in our discussions. Two of our finalists are here. Richard Hoffer, author of Something in the Air, American Passion and Defiance in the 1968 Mexico Olympics, alas, is not, but I would ask Warren St. John, author of Outlaws United, A Refugee Team, An American Town, and Will Haygood, author of Sweet Thunder, The Life and Times of Sugar Ray Robinson, please to stand. Our winning book, A Terrible Splendor by Marshall John Fisher, had, as its subtitle promised, three extraordinary men, a world poised for war, and the greatest tennis match ever played. Not all books fulfill their subtitles so splendidly. Under the looming calamity of World War II, Mr. Fisher weaves his remarkable tale of complex men, two of whom are living secret lives. And he creates not only a breathtaking read, but a terribly high standard of literary sports writing. It's going to be tough next year, and it's a great start. Thank you, ESPN, for making this possible, and thank you, Marshall John Fisher.
Thank you very much, Bob. Like a lot of writers, I spend much of my time not writing, but grumbling about what bad luck I've had throughout my career. But I have to admit, I hope I'm not the only one, I have to admit on the day I learned that Penn and ESPN were collaborating to create a new award for literary sports writing, and doing it in a rush just in time for the books published in 2009, I really had no cause to grumble that day. I felt it might be a stroke of luck. And now that I have won, I am feeling very fortunate, even though I won't be able to grumble much, at least for the next couple weeks or so. Aside from the chance of winning the award, I really wanted to be entered because of who the judges were. Bob Lipsight, who's here, and Susan Orlean, and Tim O'Brien, whose work I've admired so much. I just thought it would be really great to have these three people reading my book. And the fact that they've actually chosen it as the winner is really very gratifying, and I'm grateful to them, all three of them. And I'd also like to thank my agent, Albert Lafarge, without whom I think this book probably wouldn't have been written. About 5 years ago, I was casting out ideas for possible books, and although I loved this idea, I wasn't really sure how sellable it was. But Albert, who is a lover of literature and tennis in equal parts, jumped right on it and encouraged me to write my proposal, and everything just fell in place after that, so I'm grateful to him. Despite having refused to go to law school many years ago, my parents have still always offered me their unmitigated support and encouragement, and although they couldn't be here tonight, I'm sure they'll be listening to the podcast when it's out, so thank you, Mom and Dad. And finally, I have to thank, as I did in my book, that other great lover of literature and tennis, and that's my wife, Melita, who is here. And coming down to the city this week for this event was an unexpected and wonderful way for us to celebrate our 15th anniversary. So thank you again for this.
we're all so excited to get to the finish line with the ESPN Award, which I can't pronounce, that we forgot one award, which is very important, and those are the Open Book Awards that Alice Quinn will now return to the stage to present.
This award represents Penn's commitment to ensuring that voices from every racial and ethnic community are represented within the literary world. Given to three authors of color for outstanding book-length works published during the previous calendar year, supported by the Rochelle Ratner Fund, each winner receives $1,000. Awards go to Sherwin Bitsui for Flood Song, Robin D.G. Kelley for Thelonious Monk, The Life and Times of an American Original, and Canyon Sam for Skytrain, Tibetan Women on the Edge of History. Now, Robin Kelley can't be here, but his editor is going to accept for him. So why don't we begin with Robin Kelley, and then Sherwin and Canyon, why don't you come over here and we'll move along. Is Robin's editor here? Good.
Amiri Baraka, Jennifer Tsing, to name just a few, and I proudly stand in their company knowing that they wrote for the world. I wrote Thelonious Monk for the world as well, just as he wrote and performed music for anyone willing to listen. We are mistaken if we believe that mainstream writers speak to humanity's universal themes while others, the minorities, speak to the particular. Rather, we share the same task, to expand the universal, to make it bigger and less provincial. And in doing so, we can find one another, see each other anew, and build new communities. As Monk himself once said, I know my music can help bring people together, and that's what's important. Thank you.
My name is Sherwin Bitsui, and I am the author of Flood Song. And I just want to thank the Penn American Center and also the Penn Open Book Award judges for this distinguished award. Flood Song came to me several years ago, and it wouldn't let me go for a long time, and then finally it sang its way into the world. And to see it get the recognition it is getting, it's been really a blessed and wonderful thing. And I'd like to thank my fellow winners, and also to my to Copper Canyon Press and to Michael Wiegers, the editor, who's here in the audience. Thank you so much for taking this book on, and also to the to my family, who are obviously couldn't make it to the East Coast. I just came from Tucson this morning, and to all the people who hold on to their languages, and I really enjoy hearing all the translation awards that are going on, and someday, I always feel like I am in process all the time as a Navajo speaker, always trying to translate this world, and I think Flood Song attempts that as well, so thank you so much.
Thank you. It is a very profound honor to be chosen to receive this award, and the fact that it was rejected, turned down by the publishing community for over a dozen years, makes this recognition by the literary community very delicious. thank you. When I started this project, I was just following and fulfilling a curiosity to learn what women's experiences were in Tibet in the last 50 years of exile and how they were different than men. And I was convinced after I made one startling discovery after another that it was important to get this information out into the world and into the historical record. And that conviction kept me going, kept me motivated in the long years before it was published. I also thought it was very important to bring these stories of humanity, great humanity, courage, faith, and grace to people, to be inspired by them as I was inspired. Right now, my friend said, plug the screenplay, but I hope that I will be able to reach a lot more people through the screenplay of the book. And I also want to thank the judges of the Open Book Award this year, the Penn Center, for the exemplary work they do, especially the Nobel Peace Prize Award this year. And I would thank my publisher for doing a beautiful job, the University of Washington Press. I want to thank His Holiness the Dalai Lama for writing the foreword. And I want to thank the members of my family and my friends. I want to thank the four women who entrusted their stories to me to report. And I especially want to thank my mother and my late father. My mother is, as we say in my family, 89 looking, but she looks 65. And she hasn't traveled in 15 years, and she made the journey across the country to be here. Thank you.
And next, I'd like to invite David Henry Huang to join me on the stage to present the winners for the Penn Laura Pels Foundation Award for Drama. These are made possible by a grant from the Laura Pels Foundation. So as he does, I'd like to ask Laura Pels to stand if she's here this evening with us, so we can thank her for her generous and ongoing support. Thank you.
I think by pretty much common consent, William Shakespeare is considered the greatest dramatist in the English language, but it's interesting that when Shakespeare wrote, plays were not really considered literature. They were considered scripts, things that were performed. And in the intervening centuries, plays have become considered literature, and those of us who are dramatists agree with that assessment. But it's also a particular type of literature. It's literature that is meant to be performed, and in that sense has a great deal to do a great deal in common with music as well as with the written word. And my fellow jurors and I felt really privileged to get to have discussions about who influenced us and who we really respect and who we feel is moving the field forward in extraordinary ways. And we're very happy to present these awards. The first is the Penn Laura Pels Foundation Award for a Master American Playwright. We talked and talked and talked, and at some point, Julia Cho, my fellow juror, said, well, you know, David Mamet hasn't gotten this award before. And Nilo Cruz and I, who are considerably less organized than Julia, went, no, he's got to be on the list someplace. And in fact, he had not. And so we are incredibly happy to have a pretty easy choice in terms of someone who has had a tremendous influence not only on American drama, but on the culture at large, to present this award to David Mamet. Now, unfortunately, David Mamet could not be with us tonight, but he sent along Ron Guiazda to accept the award on his behalf.
I'm Ron Guiazda, David's agent. He couldn't be here tonight, but he asked me to read the following. Thank you for thinking of me. It has been a hoot taxing the limits of the First Amendment these last 40 years. May we all continue to do so, remembering that freedom of speech is not an award of the government, but the right of the people, from intrusion with which government has been specifically debarred. I think that's about it. With best wishes, David Mamet.
The Penn Laura Pels Foundation Award for an American Playwright in Mid-Career carries with it a cash award of $7,500, thanks to the generosity of Laura Pels, for a dramatist in mid-career whose literary achievements are vividly apparent in the rich and striking language of his or her work. I have been fortunate to see this dramatist's work for many years and admire it, and also I've traveled with her, so I know that she's kind of fun to be with. So we are very happy to present this award to Theresa Rebeck.
Thanks, David. I'd like to thank the awards committee for this great honor. I really do feel it is a great honor, and Penn, and especially I'd like to thank Laura Pels, whose name is on every great thing that happened to me this year. I mean, it happened so many times I started to wonder if she had something to do with the birth of my children. But she assures me she did not. I'd also like to say I'm very proud to be honored at the same ceremony as David Mamet. In the past couple of years, people actually have started to call me the female David Mamet, and someone even called me the feminist David Mamet, which I thought, I don't even know what that is. And then I decided it means I curse well, which in fact I do. I'm a feminist who curses well. And because of that, someone else asked me in an interview about my language, and said that my writing wasn't very ladylike. So I got to say, I'm no lady, I'm a playwright. And it's a great honor to be a playwright. Honestly, I don't think there's anyone on this planet who loves being a playwright more than me. So thank you very much.
And now, we will celebrate the Penn Robert Bingham Fellowship for Writers. It was established by the family of Robert Bingham to commemorate his love of literature, his contribution to fiction, and his support of other young writers. Supported through the generosity of Joan Bingham, Clara Bingham, and Vanessa Lilly, who join us here tonight, and who I would like to invite to stand now. You are here. I'll now invite Craig Nova to present the award. It's a long walk, but you'll make it. Everybody has.
Good evening. The first thing I'd like to do is to thank the Bingham family for its generosity in establishing this award. I can say from personal experience that writing is, above everything else, an up and down proposition, more so in the beginning than at other times, and since this is the case, it is scarcely possible to explain the impact, both practical and spiritual, a prize like this has on a writer. The award reassures. It mitigates against those hours alone in a room in which the job seems enormous, the odds of success seem long, and the isolation feels rock-ribbed and unforgiving. And so, as someone who has been on both ends of such prizes, as a recipient of other awards, and as a judge for this one, I wanted to convey my thanks, and the thanks of all writers, for the impulse to establish such a prize. It is an honor, of course, to be associated in any way with the Bingham Fellowship. Oscar Huelos and Hannah Tinty, the other judges, were of the same opinion. And part of the reason for this is the quality of the books the judges read. And I'd like to mention, in particular, two of the other finalists, Daughters of a Stone by Dalma Janos Figueroa, and In the Valley of the Kings by Terrence Holt. And that brings us to Tinkers. Novelists are great worriers, and I think this is part of a job description. And if novelists aren't worrying, they're probably worrying that they aren't worrying. They worry about ethics, morality, responsibility, and other matters, such as what is happening to the writing and quality of books they read. Then one day, they pick up a book, such as Tinker's, and suddenly everything stops. The book is so new, so fresh, so unexpected, but the novelist realizes the worries were all delusion. With books like this, precise and beautiful, written from the heart, all is well, and the future of a novel is assured. So Tinker's is a lot like the Bingham Prize itself, which is to say, it has an impact far beyond the keen pleasure of reading it. And so it is a great honor, a personal privilege, and a matter of reassurance, too, to present the 2010 Bingham Fellowship to Paul Harding.
First, I'd just like to express my gratitude to the judges and to the Binghams and to the Penn American Center for giving this absolutely amazing award. It's very humbling, and it's hard for me to express what a sort of dream come true it is to be recognized by the Penn American Center, because when I first thought of myself as wanting to be a writer, I thought of things, these embattled virtues like freedom of expression and social justice, and whenever I tried to approach them directly in my writing, I just ended up with shrill propaganda, which, if you must know, sounded like poorly translated. It had been poorly translated from execrably written Spanish. Because I was enamored of Carlos Fuentes and Julio Cortazar. And since I couldn't do that, I decided, well, I'll just write my own brand of kind of parochial birch bark metaphysics, and we'll just, you know, we'll live in parallel universes. So this means a lot to me, and I will do my best to be equal to this award, and I thank you very, very much.
And all of us at Penn tonight are very thrilled to be here and to celebrate the latest addition to the award roster. That's the Penn W.G. Sebald Award for Fiction Writer in Mid-Career. It's made possible by an anonymous donor and recognizes a mid-career writer who has already made significant contributions to American literary landscape. With this mid-career award, the judges Russell Banks, Rivka Galchin, and Jane Ann Phillips seek to honor the already considerable achievement of someone who we know and they know has much more to offer and much more to come. So presenting this award tonight will be Jane Ann Phillips.
Good evening. It's wonderful to be able to present a new award on behalf of the Penn American Center, and especially by an anonymous donor, because good writing in some strange way is always anonymous. We present this award with great pleasure to Susan Choi, one of the most singular voices working in American letters today. She's given us three stunning novels, each of them more ambitious and intimate than the one before. From The Foreign Student to American Woman, to A Person of Interest, Choi defamiliarizes figures and places in American culture that we think we know well, Patty Hearst, the Unabomber, and thus returns them to us nuanced and newly relevant. Through the refractions of fiction, she draws readers towards more true and vivid encounters with their past and present realities. Her characters exceed and contradict archetypes, complicate our sympathies, and forbid our forgetting them. Susan Choi accomplishes this work not through broad strokes, but sentence by sentence, turn by turn. Her prose is simultaneously lapidary and light, and accumulates to a magnificence. We support and applaud her body of work and warmly anticipate the work to come. Susan, can you come up and a little?
When Alice Quinn reached me by telephone to tell me that I had received this award, despite having known Alice for more than a decade and having always admired her so much, in no small part for her intelligence, I actually thought that she'd confused me for someone else. And we had a nice conversation and caught up with each other, and then I actually went online to check and make sure she had actually meant to call me. Back when I first knew Alice in the late 90s, I was preparing my first novel for publication, and W.G. Sebald's The Emigrants appeared in English that same year, and I vividly remember reading that book and being so electrified by it, by how new it felt, and also how ancient, as if it must have always existed, and feeling, in regard to my own upcoming first publication, completely swept into insignificance. I still feel that way. So it's a mind-boggling honor to receive this award. I'd like to thank the judges and the donor and Penn. And I'd also like to thank my husband, Pete Wells, who's here tonight. If this is an award for mid-career, I think he deserves it as much as me. He titled my first book, inspired my second, and pretty much kept us afloat while I wrote the third. So I couldn't have done this without him. Thank you all very much.
Our final award this evening is the Penn Saul Bellow Award for Achievement in American Fiction. It honors a living American author of fiction whose body of work in English possesses qualities of excellence, ambition, and scale of achievement over a sustained career that places him or her in the highest rank of American literature. Past recipients of this prestigious award are Cormac McCarthy and Philip Roth. Established with the cooperation of the estate of Saul Bellow and made possible this year by the extraordinary generosity of Michael Moritz, Harriet Hyman, and the J.M. Kaplan Fund, and with the kind assistance of Judith Thurman, I would now like to invite Nathan Englander to the stage to introduce this award.
Good evening. I first want to acknowledge my fellow judges, Philip Roth, who's here tonight in the dark, and Joan Acicella, who composed the statement that I'm going to read, because I always have to acknowledge whoever wrote something. Here goes. It's fitting that an award established in honor of Saul Bellow should be given to Don DeLillo. Bellow was old enough to be DeLillo's father, but literary material doesn't go away so fast. Both men deal with American life in the mid to late 20th century after World War II, and with the dark knowledge we acquired therein. In DeLillo, though, because of his later place and time, the knowledge is graver and crazier. Two forces loom over his book Underworld, the H-bomb and garbage, and much of that garbage is nuclear waste. Toxic detritus also figures prominently in White Noise, and of course, there's an important explosion in Libra. That's a lot of what DeLillo thinks of our way of life, that it is expensive, dangerous, and very strange. The strangeness creeps into Underworld gradually. First, we get realism, the stoop culture of the South Bronx in the 50s with its hopscotch and veal chops and whittled old women. We see Sister Alma Edgar, who teaches sixth grade and smells of carbolic soap. Then comes the non-realism, the hallucination conjured in DeLillo's brain by our recent history, and the astonishing linguistic performance that this unleashes. After Sister Edgar dies at the end of the book, she seems to be on her way to heaven, but she gets caught in the internet, where she's watched by a teenager sitting in front of his computer. As he goes from link to link, dragging the nun with him, he hits the homepage for the H-bomb, and Sister Edgar witnesses this explosion. She stands in the flesh and feels the power. She sees the spray plume. She sees the fireball climbing the superheated sphere of burning gas that can blind a person with its beauty, its dripping Christ blood colors, solar golds and reds. The mushroom cloud spreads around her, the pulverized mass of radioactive debris, 8 miles high, 10 miles 20, with skirted stem and smoking platinum cap. The jewels roll out of her eyes and she sees God. No, wait, sorry. It's a Soviet bomb she sees, the largest yield in history, a device exploded above the Atlantic Ocean in 1961, preserved in the computer that helped build it. It is for that combination of terror and comedy and sheer song that everyone wants to give Don DeLillo an award. Tonight, it's our turn.
I'm wearing the one suit I own. It's my book award and funeral suit. Sometimes these occasions can seem indistinguishable. not tonight, however, and certainly not from my viewpoint. Saul Bellow's work continues to resonate strongly, even after all these decades. The rich, invigorating language of his fiction, the breadth and range of that American voice, and the noise his characters made, ideas bouncing around in their heads, pouring off their tongues. The Victim was the first Bellow novel I read, and Herzog was probably the deepest and most enjoyable experience I had as a reader of his work. In those days, the mid-60s, I was the reader who inhaled works of fiction. And there was something in that book and that character, Moses Herzog, that allowed me nearly to convince myself that this is the novel I would be writing, my first novel, if only Bellow hadn't beaten me to it. That was the year of Herzog, when I met the other writer associated at the time with the city of Chicago. This was Nelson Algren, who generously offered to read some of my short fiction and who occasionally delivered arias of writerly complaint on various subjects, money, women, publishing business, and so on. All that summer, people approached Algren and asked him about the new novel that was receiving enormous attention and acclaim. This, of course, was Herzog, and Nelson's answer never varied. The only Herzog he knew was Buck Herzog, played second base for the Cubs in the 1920s. This was my introduction to the literary life in America. I never met Saul Bellow, but we exchanged a couple of letters late in his career, and it was strange to me still that I might be receiving warm words from a writer whose work had enlarged my perceptions of the world and of contemporary fiction, and how remarkable it seems this evening, that I might be standing here to receive an award that bears Saul Bellow's name. Thank you.
And before the evening comes to a close, I'd like to introduce the Executive Director of the Pen American Center for his first ever literary awards in that position, Mr. Steve Eisenberg. Sorry, Steven.
It is my happy duty to end this evening of honoring the very bond and identity that defines Penn, the distinctive work of writers and their tie with readers, and those in the literary community, and all those who make our awards possible. And so, congratulations again to all finalists and award recipients. I want to thank Ina Howard Parker for her grace and skill that so carried the ceremony. And many thanks to all our presenters and the Penn Awards Committee, Eileen Smith, Scott Spencer, Monique Trong, and our abundant thanks to our Awards Committee Chair, Alice Quinn, for donating so many hours of her time and for her knowledge, enthusiasm, and judgment, which are so impressively combined. Special thanks to Chancellor Goldstein and the head of the Graduate Center, William P. Kelley, two academic leaders of distinction, and the Graduate Center of CUNY for hosting the event. To all the donors, we are so grateful for the kind and ample generosity you have shown, which gives life to the awards. The estate of Saul Bellow, and I hope that she is with us tonight, Saul Bellow's widow, Janice Bellow. Would you stand if you're here, please? To Michael Moritz and Harriet Heyman, now I'm still in the Saul Bellow line. And also special thanks to Walter Posen, Judith Thurman, Ben Taylor. And most especially to the most thrilling lunch I've had since I became executive director with one of my heroes, Philip Roth. Philip, could you stand? Why should I claim him as my hero? He's a hero to millions. The J.M. Kaplan Fund, the family of Robert Bingham, Joan Bingham, Clara Bingham, and Vanessa Lilly, who you met earlier tonight. Stand up again so we can thank you. Jackie Weld and Rodman Drake, did they slip in late? Well, they know how much they have our thanks. For Robert Lipsyte, ESPN is a big television conglomerate. But I came into work one morning, and I called two of my old colleagues from Newsday who have not been recognized tonight. And I said, hi, it's just like one of those old days when the publisher comes in and he has an idea. And I said, what would you guys think of creating the first ESPN award for literary sports writing? And they said, brilliant, we'll do it. Will you help me thank John Walsh and Gary Honig of ESPN. I wish to thank Hans Voelcker, Phyllis Reynolds Naylor, Lily Tuck, Ray Delvin, the Kaplan Foundation, the Rochelle Ratner Fund, Amazon.com, and in a way that the word should reach them, our anonymous donors. Please recognize them all with me and thank all these donors. Now, I'm in a small struggle right now, and I'm going to give in to it. If there's anyone here who should have been thanked and wasn't, please stand up and tell me now, because it'll be miserable in the morning when you call me and say, well, please, is there anyone? I really mean it. Don't call me tomorrow. Within the next several days, we're going to announce two new literary awards. Keep watching this space. There is a new blossoming attached to our literary awards, and it builds on the past, and it points to an exciting future for all our donors, judges, publishing houses, and agents, and winners and finalists yet to come. We salute your professional dedication and imaginative craft that so much deserve attention. This is one signature part of Penn's charter and purposes, the promotion of literature. The awarding of laurels is an ancient part of literary culture, and it continues to play a vital role. On Friday, Lu Xiaobo, of whom Anthony spoke, an essayist and poet and one of the founders of the Independent Chinese Pen Center, currently serving an 11-year prison sentence, handed down because of things he wrote, won the Nobel Peace Prize. We at Pen American Center are proud to have played a part in garnering support for that recognition, having worked with Lu's wife and friends and our colleagues from Independent Chinese Pen, from his detainment to his sentencing, right up to Anthony Appiah's wonderful letter of nomination of Lu for that award. We will continue to press his case and others like it until he is released, and we will continue to fight for freedom of expression everywhere. We welcome your support and participation in these efforts. This Tuesday, October 19th, at 7 p.m. in the Great Hall of Cooper Union, we will join with the Committee to Protect the Journalist in an evening of solidarity with our Mexican colleagues and journalists in Mexico. As you know, most perilous ground for those who report the news. One of tonight's honorees, Don DeLillo, will join us that night, along with several other writers and journalists from Mexico and the United States. We hope to see you there. Finally, without mentioning their names, but embracing them all, I want to thank our staff for the wonderful work they did in making this evening all it has been. We applaud and thank you.
Laura Pels wasn't good enough to take up Steve's invitation to remind us of her role as a donor. Perhaps I could do it for her. So I should just add her to the list of our supporters.
Now we come to the end of the evening. On behalf of everyone at Penn, I'd like to thank you so much for coming out to celebrate literature. Please stay in your seats until the winners and the jurors have left the room, and there will be a reception afterwards out in the space there where you can buy each of the books, and I hope you will do so, and meet the writers and congratulate them in person. And also, please do not forget to buy tickets to Tuesday's State of Emergency Censorship by Bullet in Mexico. Thank you so much for being here this evening. Good night.